Hey guys, so after that last video, a few of you asked me to do another one actually showing a little more detail and going in a little more in depth. That's what we're doing here. So just to kick it off really quickly here, what we're doing is we're going to show you the differences between my system that I have now and the old system. After that, we're going to show you some of the tools you're going to need to do this job properly. After that, we're going to show you how to take apart the inside of your car and what you're going to need to look for and how to do that, get into more detail with that later. Finally, after that, we're going to show you the basics behind the electronics and how it all fits together and goes in. So just a little bit of history here with this car, just to give you some background information here really quick. This is my 2004 Chevy Epica. It has running lights that come standard on it, but these have been disabled. To do that, all I did was I went to my fuse box and I pulled my running light fuse out. That triggered a light inside the dash saying that my daytime running lights were out. So all I did was I took apart my dash and I pulled out the little light bulb that turned on there. The reason I did that in the first place was because that there was actually problems with that system, and it's a problem with the computer because it would, when I got the car, they never worked. After a few years, when I'd be getting up early to go to work at like 6 a.m., it was dark out and it would trigger the lights. It wasn't dark enough that I needed to use my headlights, but the daytime running lights would come on for about 5 minutes and shut off after that. After a few months, that just got really annoying, so I went with this system here. Alright, just to show you a little bit of what's different between this system and the old one. First and foremost, the location of the lights. These lights are inside my headlight. You can see? They're inside there. The last one, they are mounted between the headlight and the bumper. And that causes a lot of issues in different areas. Firstly, the system that I used, used silicone. And if you look here, you can see there's a little rippling right here. That's actually silicone still sitting on top of my paint. If you look right here, you can see that. That is where I've sanded down. It's been repainted, but it needs another coat, and it needs some clear on it still. And I got to sand down over here to get it looking nice. It's not that noticeable from far away, but it's still bodywork that really needs to be done to restore this back to how it was. So for that reason, I recommend going against what my last video with the silicone there. Worked great in theory, worked great for a little while. With this one, the other disadvantage with having it between your headlight, you can see this is sitting properly, it's sitting normally. You can see how little space there actually is in there. They're almost butting up perfectly together. Now what that would do, with this headlight actually raised up here, that would cause issues with my hood right here. It would sit up a bit. Right now it's sitting nice and flush. It's great. It's got a little bit of a gap here, nothing too crazy. Before this was about probably a quarter inch, even a half inch gap there. And right here as well, you can see it's sealing up. That's normal. That's what I want there. Before, it was about twice that. So that's one of the issues. All right, so just to show you guys what this method actually does with this product is it cycles the color. Now, the reason that's important is if you notice how bright that white is, when the amber actually lights up with it, it's extremely hard to see from any kind of distance, which really defeats the purpose of this whole modification. Because, you know, A, you want it to be more visible, and B, you want it to look cool. So I feel that's what this this does here. Now when the manufacturer drafted up their wiring diagrams, what they specified was to have that white light on all the time. Then the amber light would come on with your signal light. And that's not what's happening here. What's happening here is they're cycling the color. They're alternating. When the white light is on with that amber light, it's really hard to see that amber from far away. So that kind of defeats the whole purpose of even putting these on, because you want to be more visible and you want to look your car to look better, right? So when they come on together, it really doesn't do much of anything. It just kind of makes a weird sort of browny color. So anyway, let's get into a little more detail here and show you what you need to do this. So here's basically everything you're going to need for this job. Some of it's optional. So just to get into it quickly from the top here, we have a cordless drill. It's nice to have for taking apart interior parts. Not necessary. You can do everything with a screwdriver set, but it's nice to have. Completely optional. Next to it here, we have a code reader. What this is nice for is it checks the check engine light and find out what it means. Again, optional. Really nice to have though. Down here, also optional, but I would definitely recommend these. These are what I like to call panel poppers. These are used for taking apart the interior of your car. The majority of your car is held together with screws and clips. These help pop off these clips. You can see it's really flexible. You can see how much I'm torquing it there at the end. Bounces right back. They're soft, but they're firm. And it's great for taking off panels. But more importantly, what this is going to do is it won't scratch your panels. you use a screwdriver, I guarantee you, you're going to end up scratching something and it's not going to look pretty. Over here, we have a multimeter. Not necessary, but you do need at least a test light to find out which is hot and which is ground for this system. If you can get your hands on one, get your hands on one, because they will help so much, and it's better altogether. Over here, we've got solder. It's a must-have. We have electrical tape, also a must-have. This is Scotch vinyl electrical tape. It's approved by Canadian Safety Association or something, the CSA. Anyway, don't cheap out on this. Splurge, you get the $3 or $4 rolls. You don't want to get the six-pack. That's for $2. And I think I have one of these here. They're from Canadian Tire. This was given to me in my defense. This is, it says, vinyl electrical tape six-pack. Don't get these. Stay away from these. They have an extremely low tack, and they are extremely brittle. And it's basically just crap. That's a backup if I ever do need it. This one, though, it's extremely tacky, which means it has a great adhesive on it is great. It's also extremely stretchable. And the reason for that is because when you go through a temperature flux, here, for example, in Alberta, Canada, we have 70 degrees Celsius temperature flux. What that means is we go from plus 30 in the summer to minus 40 in the winter. And that causes issues with expansion and contraction, obviously. When it boils down to the vinyl electrical tape, it ends up coming off after a little while if you get some really cheap stuff. So it never hurts, even with this, just to put, you know, a few extra rolls on it when it's in the engine compartment, because if it starts to unwind, it gets dirt in it, it won't re-tack. So just keep that in mind. Don't cheap out on electrical tape. You need to get the expensive stuff if you want this to last. Moving on. This is a must-have. This is a soldering pen. I know some of you out there may like to crimp, and, you know, if you want to crimp, go for it. But I definitely recommend solder. The reason being is because a solder connection is stronger than the wire itself. You have nothing to worry about in terms of it coming undone. With a crimped connection, if it's not done properly, and even if it is done properly, it can sometimes come out. And we're not going to get into the basics of that, but basically, as a safety issue with this as well, these things can get really hot. So if you're working on it and you have it on the floor, put it under your car, just kind of like that, you know? It's out of the way. It's not going to burn anything in the immediate vicinity. And more importantly, you're not going to step on it. And my old one, I actually broke it because I stepped on it too many times, and it just stopped working. The other thing with that is if you accidentally drop something on it, it won't burn because it's under the car, right? So it's a lot harder to drop something on it. Another thing is a safety hazard too. If you happen to lose your balance while you're crouching down trying to get at something in the door, for example, and you fall backwards, you put your hand out and you put it out and it lands on that soldering pen, it's going to hurt. And trust me, it will not be pretty. I've burned myself on these before and it sucks. Moving on though, here we have wire strippers. This one is a really older style, but you can see it basically it clamps on the left. On the right here, we've got the different diameters of wire. It cuts it, it separates it, it releases the cut end, ejects the old end. They work great. Don't get the ones that kind of look like this, you know, that have a number of holes in them. If you really know how to use those well, you know, by all means, but I find that they're just not really that good. Especially in situations like this, where you will be doing a lot of work, where you don't have the leverage to actually pull on the wire itself. These come in way, way handier when you need to be able to just use one hand, get the wire in there, and go. So anyway, moving on. You want a knife, and that'll be for, again, stripping, but in a different way. Also just for cutting off lengths or whatever, it's just nice to have. You're definitely going to need a set of snips for cutting wires and zip ties and other stuff. And also screwdrivers, must have, even if you have a drill. There's some spots you can't get a drill, so you need a set of screwdrivers. Down here, if you go with the alternating lights, well, either way, you're going to need wire, but 5 for the alternating because of the relays, 2 or 3 if you just go with the manufacturer's way. So here we have a 12-volt DC automotive relay. And on the top here, it's going to be too blurry, I think, for you guys to see, so I'll just read it off to you. Mosquito here, sorry. It says ProLink SD or SPDT40P. That's the code number there. And what it says is it's got NO, which means when it's open, 40 amp, 14 volt DC. And C when it's closed, 30 amp, 14 volt DC. So basically, the gist of that, it's basically rated at least 30 amps on 14 volts. Now, your car is at what's called a 12-volt system, but it pretty much maxes out at around 14 volts. For our system here, we, if you recall back to the old one, we've got it fused at 1 amp. So this one's going to be more than enough. You can get anything, you know, I'd say probably 5 amps and up, and you're good to go. In here, we've got a set of diodes. These are rectifier diodes. For this project, we'll be using diode type, I guess, N4004. If you go to the source, you can actually get these ones. That's where I got these. And you just have to look at the back. It'll have a list of all the different types. This is a variety pack. It's got a ton of them in it. But they should have at least two N4004s in them. So, yeah, let's get started on taking this apart.